Multidisciplinary director. I create very highly stylized outfits with a very safe space approach to my sets. I'm here to talk to you about the theme of vibrancy today. So first of all, here's just a little bit about my background, where I come from, how I started in the industry, and the context of why I'm here talking to you about this theme in particular. So, unlike a lot of directors, I actually started in fashion editorial, and I started as a stylist and as an art director. I didn't come up through camera department. So a lot of my work is very much focused on color, on texture, on lighting, on pattern, and on set, rather than the technical elements. I'll be really honest and say, until I became a director, I was much more engrossed and enthusiastic about the physical realm of things in front of camera rather than the technical side of things. But as I became a director, I really started to understand what a piece of kit can really do for you and how meshing the technical with the artistic can create a really beautiful creative output. So just on to the next slide there. So as you can see, my work is very, very colorful. You can also see how I started in stills. So it's very evident that I have like a very particular style, and it's quite in your face, it's quite garish, but there is a way of everything meshing together and looking quite cohesive still. As well as being an art director, I also prior to that was a dancer for approximately like 10 years. So throughout my work, you'll see a lot of movement, a lot of transition, and a lot of expression through that. I've always felt that dance is such a good way to express an emotion as opposed to anything else. Furthermore from that, in terms of like the kind of work I do tend to do quite out there work, and it is normally a combination of video and photos, hence my background, and it works very well in this current industry where content rollout is a big part of the process. In terms of, sorry, I'm just going to check here for my notes every so often, guys, so sorry for my back being to you. It's evident that my background has informed my obsession with my work, whether it be colour connotation, texture and tone, pattern, expression, or just using composition very well, even when it comes to video format. So I'm also on the cusp of the internet generation. I hate to say that. I'm in between a Gen Z and a millennial. I work for both spaces. But it's also got me employed a lot. As well as enjoying the internet and the digital side of things, that also means I enjoy physical, true art in its truest form. Now, that means I have a very different perspective than your average video director. It means I'm unique and I stick out. I'm vibrant. And unlike I did in secondary school, where I kind of shied away from that, I was like, oh my God, I don't want to be the odd one out. Now I truly embrace that when it comes to my creative work, and it's got me a lot of employment, a lot of jobs, a lot of great connections, and a lot of great clients. So to give you context of my video work, here's a little show of it. There was sound.
There's one sound.
But we're okay. As you can see, a lot of color, a lot of pattern, a lot of texture, a lot of movement. I like different things. I like artsy things. I don't like to do anything that is regular or the norm, and that even translates to my commercial work, which we'll talk about in a little bit. I also like cult film. So I'm going to talk about translating your work to a commercial space. So sometimes we're told when we're coming up in industry that we need to tone it down. We need to be less vibrant in order to get that commercial client. I don't think that's the case at all, especially if you're trying to stay true to your style. I think it's about translating your work for a commercial client, being able to see what the client likes within your work and pull that out for them. It doesn't mean that you need to tone yourself down or that you need to become different in order to have a commercial output. What that really means is that you're able to see through the noise of what the client is telling you and pick out what they really want from you, because at the end of the day, they employed you for you, your creative work, your vision, and your creative choices. So it's about adapting, it's about seeing what the problem is and solving it, but you're the person they chose to solve it. So why would you tone yourself down in order to give an output? So for example, my biggest advice whenever you do anything commercial, any advice I give to anyone, is to just make sure that within that project, whether it be part of the process or be part of the output, that there is one element in there that is truly you. Because of course you've got to adhere to what a client needs and what a client wants and what its customer is going to consume and what it's going to appreciate seeing. But at the same time, we didn't do this job as a creative in order for you to just bend to everyone's will. You did it because you're creative and an artist truly at heart. So that means that you can take elements of things that you like, whether it be Dutch camera angles, fast-paced transitions, color and tone that you typically use, and just put a little element of that into the commercial work, because then your style will ring through. I also feel like it really makes sure that your heart is still in it, that you still love the piece at the end of the day, and even though it's a commercial output, you're gonna absolutely love what you've created, or you're gonna love part of it, and then it's gonna be a better output as a result. Next. The benefits of sticking to your guns and your creative choices. Basically, I think that me sticking to my guns and not really deviating and not toning myself down and not becoming less vibrant because it's going to get me more work has led me to getting some incredible clients that suit me down to a T. Although this is a very commercial output, whenever you look at it and you see poppy colors, vibrancy, brutalist architecture, and floral set design, I could be talking about a music video that I've done, but no, it's a completely commercially viable output and it suits me. I've been able to gain clients that make sense for me, and it's a great relationship between us because we know that our, at some point along the way, although we're not totally aligned, we're going to align at some point. It means that I've been able to create a life that suits me, and I never feel like I'm truly compromising my beliefs or who I am in order to work with a commercial client, which at the end of the day is a big space that we all want to be in. It always means, like, I work with like a lot of females, indie bands and stuff like that, but I also love working with commercial clients in advertising because I think there's a lot more scope and space to be really, really creative within that, within guidelines. I always feel like the guidelines that a commercial client gives you are stricter than those when you do music videos, but I always feel like those constrictions actually make me dive into my creative process a lot harder and make sure that I know what part of myself that I'm going to take forward in that piece of work. So moving forward, so these are the things that mean vibrancy to me. It's not just color. It means trusting your instincts and your ability. Having enough faith in yourself that you know that even if someone tells you no, even if you get rejected, even if you pitch and you pitch and only one of those 10 pitches goes through, that you know that you're good enough. You know that you deserve to be in the space and you deserve to take up space. That's what being vibrant is about to me. Not being afraid of the challenge. Yes, you may not have done something in a brief before, but that does not mean you cannot do it. Just because there's one bullet point in there that you don't fit, doesn't mean that you fit all of the other bullet points a lot better than the other person who fits all of them. You might fit not one of them, but you fit the others better. Believing in your creative choices. So I think whenever you approach a client, or you talk to a client, or you talk to talent, even when you're with them on set, you've got to believe in yourself, because if you don't believe in yourself, how are they going to believe in you? If you don't feel like you're good enough to do the job, or you don't think that the talent looks amazing, how are they going to believe that they look amazing? Vibrancy for me, also a huge part of my career, has been absorbing my surroundings, who I'm with, whether that be the interesting people that I've met along the way, the amazing places I've seen, the books I've read, the pictures I've seen, the films I've seen, the art galleries I went to. Truly absorbing solely the elements that work for you. You don't have to absorb everything. We're in a space where everyone feels like they need to consume all the time. Make sure what you're consuming is appropriate for you, particularly on social media. Empowering the people around you. A massive part of my ethos is empowering individuality in people, because I've empowered it in myself. I'm talking about obviously the talent or the dancers that you've got or whoever it may be, empowering them to make them feel like they're the best in front of the camera, but that also lends into your crews. They are your best asset, they are your best team member, they are your best friend, they are the ones that are going to make what you have in your head come to life. You have to empower those people. You have to make sure that they feel safe, that they've drank enough water, that they have lunch, that they feel comfortable to come and talk to you, that you're friendly and open enough that they can come and approach you with a problem so it doesn't turn into an actual problem. And then finally, for me, vibrancy is about the ability to hustle, hustle, hustle. Keep it going. Get up when you get knocked down. It's going to happen. We're in an industry where that happens all the time. You know, you can become a very, very established director and you're still not going to win every pitch. It's just not going to happen. So it's that ability to pick yourself up off the ground, keep going, and right back to the top. Trust your instincts and ability. Trust that in this hustle culture, one thing's going to come through. That one thing will lead to two, that two will lead to three, and then it'll keep going, and suddenly you're on a wheel and you're like, maybe I didn't even want to be on this wheel, this one's going too fast. Anyway, those are the main points that I would say are vibrancy for me in this industry. So, and lastly, a huge thing that I think when I think about vibrancy
is that it doesn't just apply to your work. It applies to your character. It applies to your demeanor. It applies to, if I talk to you one-on-one, I guarantee you I'm about to be pretty much the same as what you've just seen in front of you here. I'm going to talk with my hands, I'm going to talk too much, I'm going to ramble on, and then I'm going to get back to the point. But what that's led is for me to have very dedicated crews, very dedicated clients, people who would genuinely like actually have a beautiful day working with me and come up to me and say, I haven't felt like this on set before. Or a dancer saying to me, no one's ever asked me if I want water in between a take, which is silly to me, but it's proven that I've gotten pretty far in my career just through my character and demeanor and the vibrancy that I bring to people and the fact that I make them feel comfortable. Now, what that's allowed me to do is that it's allowed me to open up other avenues and multiple streams of income, aka, I know today is a volunteer situation, but I do a lot of panel talks. I do them for the likes of like BBC Introducing, I do them for Show Studio, I do them for Nowness. So I've created a whole avenue in my career simply by remaining authentic to myself, never shying away from showcasing who I am on social media, even though it's a bit cringe, even though it's a bit embarrassing. I've always remained true and authentic to who I am, and I get employed for that. I do social activations as well, where, no, I don't have a huge following. I really don't, but my engagement is good. People like interacting with me. They actually comment and interact and want advice from me, which means that brands then want to invest in me as a result because they know that my customer base is also their customer base. What that's mean is that for me, my character and my demeanor are as vibrant as my work. When you meet me, my work makes sense. When you see my work and see me, it's all a cohesive package. There's no, everything's laid bare there for you to see. So I've stuck to my guns. I've championed individuality in myself, and I've championed it in others. And that's got me employed, and it's keeping me employed to this day. It's led to me to so many beautiful opportunities, and for me, the two are completely intertwined. You can't see me without my work, and my work wouldn't look as it does without me being there on set, and me being around the people that make that work happen. What that's meant is that I've had the beautiful opportunity, and it's taken a long time, to create not only people who surround me that suit me to a T, but a client list that suits me to a T. And now people are coming not only for my work, but for me. So my main advice from this is stay true to yourself. Stay authentic. It does not, your journey, yourself does not have to look like anyone else. It has to look like you. And it has to be as vibrantly you as possible.
Super, super inspiring, and I'm sure it's thrown up questions in everyone. I certainly would love to kick off and ask you, like, everything you're saying is like, I think the way a lot of everyone wants to show up authentically, right? And everyone wants to kind of follow that mantra of like, you know, not listening to the naysayers and just doing you and following your path. But obviously it's a lot easier said than done, right? Were there situations or along your journey or pieces of work that, so obviously you've gotten to where you are now,
yeah.
So along the way that you found yourself, you know what, this isn't sitting well with me, this isn't my kind of people, this isn't my kind of
yeah.
work to get you, so it wasn't the case if you woke up one morning like this.
No, of course not. Like, it took a long time. It took me dealing with a lot of problem solving, let's put it that way, like a lot of me figuring out what works for me and what doesn't work for me, the type of people that I want to be surrounded by, and that's only
yeah.
through like trial and error. That's genuinely how you learn that and how you get yourself around like comfortable crews and how you get better at, you know, directing or editing or art directing or whatever you want to do. Even if you're a musician, it's by trial and error, really. And it's also about, I watched this thing the other day. It's like we try to make a decision before we've tried things out.
Mm-hmm.
You have to try it out in order to make a decision. Otherwise, it's not an informed decision. It's just projection. So in order for you to know whether you like it or whether you don't like it, you have to try it.
I think sometimes you think you can deliberate over a decision for so long, and in all those weeks or months, whatever you're thinking about the decision, you could have just done it realised it was wrong, and then moved on to the right decision, mm-hmm. if you know what I mean? Like, but it's,
and that's why my advice is to just retain one thing mm-hmm. per project, because even if the rest of the project like is not something that you like, you know within it that there was that one thing that you can be proud of. So it's not going to be every project that you absolutely adore, and you're not going to adore, there's no project you're going to adore from A to Z. You're going to get stressed out in the middle, someone's going to annoy you, like it's just going to happen, like, and you have to pivot and change and problem solve, and that's a big part of our job. But if you have that one thing you can like hold on to in the midst, you're like, okay, it's okay.
I think it's so true, isn't it? It's like taking one thing away, and I know like in the work that I do as a producer as well, not every work is going to be that speaks to you, but there'll be something, there'll be a learning from it, or there'll be something about that whole journey that you'll go, you know what, this is what I'm going to take from it for next time. Like, if it's not the final project, it'll be something within it, or a great contact, or someone,
something like that. Like, I did a project with the Heritage Gang, who represent me here in Ireland, by the way. I did a project with them, and it was for like hotel concierge. Am I okay? Yeah, it was for hotel concierge, and look, that like makes no sense, but I did like super cool like whip transitions in it, which I don't have in my portfolio, and I did like little pop-up like AI pop-ups, which is all the rage like now, which I don't have in my portfolio. So though it's like, you know, for like a hotel,
it wasn't an immediate fit, but actually
it wasn't an immediate things aren't going to be an immediate fit, but I walked away and I was like, do you know what, that was cool, I like that, that was a good shot, like I definitely, that's going in my showreel. So it's not directly aligned, but there's something within it that makes it feel like you.
Yeah, absolutely. Does anyone have any questions they'd like to ask? Actually, know there's one at the back. Zoe.
Hi. I'd love to know, when you get an initial idea for something, how does that expand from the start? Like, do you take notes, voice notes, Pinterest
notes,
stuff like that? How do you, like, when you get an idea in your head, where does it go from the start to the beginning?
I have a different process for advertising and commercial work versus music videos. Music videos, really straight, simple, straightforward. I was a dancer, I stick my headphones on, and I imagine what's happening. And then I make it from that, obviously getting all my references together and stuff like that. When it's advertising and commercial, I tend to take what the client needs are. So I do like a board of what the client is looking to hit. Who's the demographic, or you know, what is the key points of the brief, and I do the same for their customer base, and then I try to take an idea that melds both of those together so that we're happy. And with my referencing, you know, it's online, it's magazines, it's art galleries, it's not just I don't just use advertisements to inform my work about advertisements, otherwise it's going to look like a replication of something that someone else has done before. Like I said, my uniqueness is my selling point, so the fact that I have these artsy fartsy references, I'm definitely going to bring those in. Then after that, I kind of build out through scripting. So once I've gotten a plethora of like references and I kind of have like a good visual idea of where I'm going, then I script it out and then take the visual references that align best with what I've scripted, that adheres to the client and consumer basis, and then apply the visuals to that afterwards. So it's a bit of a, music videos is a lot more innate to a certain extent and natural, but advertising is more of a process, I would say. Like, it's more of a, I need to really get to the nitty gritty of the analytics and stuff like
and
that.
And I guess music programmers, there's maybe a little bit more opportunity to be fluid and creative, whereas there's going to be more boxes to tick usually in advertising, more messaging.
Which
more
is why strategy. It has to be a bit more like, this is a process I have to follow. Music, it's just so, so different every single time, so individual to each, you know, person, each track is different. So it's just a lot more free versus a lot more process orientated on commercials and that.
Anyone else got any more questions? One here.
It's, I guess my question is a little less about the creative side and more about the business side of the whole thing about character and demeanor and sticking to your guns, and how does that translate to, say, negotiating or demanding, like, showing you know your worth?
I'm really good at asking for more with a lovely smile on my face, or just like truly, like, everyone, whenever I come on, any client, when I come on a call, I'm never really on that call unless I'm actually enthused about the project and I truly want to make it the best possible thing that I could. That's how I look at like every project. Like, why am I doing it if it's not for the best possible reason? So when I come onto a call with a client and we're talking from a business perspective of how that helps me, they can just tell the authenticity and the honesty that I'm coming with. I'm not trying to hoodwink you. I'm not trying to get more money for no reason. I'm on, like, the only, you know, reason, whether it be like budget or it be like constrictions on thing, is because I think it's going to affect the creative output, the quality of the work that's come out of it. So I think me just showing up like authentically and honestly just gives them comfort that I'm believing in the project. Now when it comes to like then sticking my guns, if I'm getting on a call and it just feels like I'm being constricted and pushed down, and you know, I'm having to, obviously you pivot and you problem solve and you do as much as you can, you know, but then that's why I'm very lucky I have beautiful representation that, you know, can step in and, you know, when it comes to that line and kind of say, this is so far away from where we were originally. Like, it's fine to pivot and problem solve and change, and budget can change things, and you know, you need another deliverable, like things like that. That's absolutely fine. But when it comes to actually constricting you, it comes to a point where you've kind of got to either like put your foot down if you're an individual and you're doing this independently, which I was before representation. Or you have beautiful representation who can be, I didn't like doing it because I show up authentically, like it, you can kind of see on my face when I'm like disappointed, you know what I mean? So I have other people who can step in and kind of like be like, that's too far away from where we originally were, you know? That's how it helps me and hinders me to a certain extent, yeah. Mm-hmm.
There's another question back there.
Yes, there's quite a lot of variation in your work. I just wondered, how do you keep it fresh? How do you stop yourself from running out of ideas? Or do you ever get stuck where you're like in a creative rush?
Yes, I do. I do definitely, especially it is difficult. Like, I have a very like high output of the number of treatments that I do, so it's quite a lot. It's more than probably your average director would get out for the week, and it does sometimes mean that I'm a little bit like, oh my god, what? Like, I've already treated for like, you know, phones three times this week. Like, how can I create a new idea from that? But I think what helps me is that I never stop, like I said, absorbing. And I'm talking about like even when you're walking down the street, I'm talking about your conversation that you had in the bar when you were drunk last night. You don't know what idea that sparked or whatever. Like, there's so many sources of inspiration. And I think also some people are so sometimes either glued down to their phone or what the project has to be, that they don't see what's in front of them. You know, that they don't see that there are so many inspiration sources if you just look literally to your left and your right and on, you know? So stay fresh. I think I stay fresh by continuing to live, like in terms of like what I do in my day-to-day life, going traveling. I do, you know, when I completely get in a creative rut, I'm like, bye everyone, see you in a month or so. I need this because I know that I can't give my best if I'm not at my best. It's also really, truly, like, creatives really need to learn to rest. I'm the worst hypocrite for this. I literally flew over here for this yesterday, so it's like, you know, I'm the worst hypocrite. But it's about, but then this weekend, I'm not touching anything because I know I'm into three shoots for the next week and a half, as well as editing at the same time. So I'm taking this weekend, and I'm not talking to anyone, I'm just doing what I need to do. You've got to remember that you can't give out if you're empty. Like, you can't feed into an idea if you're empty. You need to be full in order to do that. I'm not sure if that answers.
No, that's
real. It's just honest. Like, yes, of course I do. Like, as everyone does, everyone gets writer's block. But it's that hustle. Get up, go again. Okay, that idea was shit. Admit it, you know, and move on. Don't get bogged down in an idea that was shit. Know that the next one will be better.
Yeah, hi. So how much of your work do you storyboard or do you visualise beforehand? And then do you have a production team that you work with in particular, or are there key people?
So with my work, I will usually have like an exact idea of what it's going to end up looking like, even down to a beat edit. Beat edit for context is like 0 to 5 seconds is going to be this shot. 5 to 10 is going to be this shot. So I have a really, really clear idea of what that's going to end up looking like. Shoot days, some things can change, but usually I'm very much like what I have planned in my head is what I come out with at the end. And again, I think that's my fashion editorial background, because I think even down to the shoes that the person is wearing, it's not just, we're going to put the camera here and then that's it. You know, there's so many details in my work already that I have to be on top of. So yeah, I storyboard a lot. And then what was this?
Just the production team then, does it change or do you have a reliable
So whilst I'm here in Ireland, reliable team, my lovely heritage team, and they pretty much, you know, it's them and that's it. Whenever I work in the UK, I am an independent with a director's rep. So per job, it's a different team. I obviously have my regulars that I return to, and I know that they're good for a certain type of work, and blah, 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 but I do try to switch it up. And a big part of my thing is, like the last hits, you know, empowering individuality and empowering others. I have a lot of young crew, so people who are like 18, 19, 20. Like, it took me a long time to try and knock down doors. So I have those young assistants, you know, on set, shadowing, getting to know. They can even do the social BTS for the day, you know, and just get some experience where it might be really hard for them to get it elsewhere. So I'd say here is like a little bit more set. It's a smaller pool to pull from as well here, which is something that is very important. Whereas when I'm in the UK, like it's a very wide pool and there's a wide variety of people who are appropriate for different types of work. I've also found that when I'm here, people tend to do, in the UK, it's like you do one type of work. And even if you're a producer, you do one type of work. Hence you're only good for a certain type of job. Whereas here, it's like people tend to do, if you're a producer, you're doing short film, narrative, advertising and music videos. So it allows you to have more set teams here, if that makes sense.
Any final question before we wrap?
Don't be shy, sorry.
Oh, good. One last question for me, just if there is, looking at your career in the next sort of 5-10 years, what is the ambition, the goal? Like, what would you love to be doing? Like, more of the kind of work you're doing, or where would you love to?
I mean, I'd love to just honestly keep going with what I'm doing and really hone out a section of the industry that's for myself and like unique to me. I definitely want to approach more advertisements and more commercials than I have done before. I've got experience in them, but I would love a lot more plethora of experience there. So it's getting better, it's gaining more inspiration, it's meeting more crew and more people, and just really developing. Keep developing, keeping that authenticity, but developing as I change as well. Like, you don't have to remain the same the whole time.
Yeah.
It's about just authenticity to who you are in that moment.
Amazing. Well, on that note, thank you so much. Thank you, Roisin.